way towards the end of our study in 1 John. And we want to focus this morning just on a couple verses here that speak of our confidence before God and speak of the privilege that we have in prayer. We want to take some time to unfold this passage and look at that. But if I don't have time to unfold this and to look at everything that we want to look at, I want you to know what we're driving at. So I'm going to give you the big idea first. So if we don't get to it, you already know what it is. Here's the big idea. We have it written on your handout, on your note page. But the big idea is this, that Christians pray with bold expectation because they know who they are and whose they are. Now, as you do that, when you look at that on your page, would you just insert one word for me? Christians should pray. Because we don't always do it this way. We don't always pray with this bold expectation. We don't always pray with this bold confidence. So just write that in. And here's the big idea. Christians should pray with a bold expectation because we know who we are. We know whose we are, who we belong to. And really, that's what John is driving at just in these few phrases that he includes in this bigger presentation. We're in 1 John, John's first letter. It's at the end of your Bible. So if you go to the end and you go Revelation and then Jude and then 3 John and 2 John and 1 John. We're in chapter 5 of 1 John, and we're going to pick this up really at verse 13. Look at how John records this, how it's recorded for us as John wrote this. These things I have written to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. And this is the confidence which we have before him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us in whatever we ask, we know that we have the which we have asked from him. That's a bold confidence. You know, as we look at that, and just maybe understand this again in context, John keeps coming back to this theme. There are a couple different themes in here, but one of the themes that John keeps coming back to is, I want you to know, so that you may know, that you may know. And John wants us to know that. And partially, that's with the backdrop, again, of Gnosticism. Gnosticism was the prevailing corrupt theology, corrupt religious system that was invading the church. And Gnosticism, even by its very name, was the religion of special knowledge. If you want to work your way back to godness, you have to have this special knowledge. And in contrast to that, in opposition to that, John says, no, this is what I really want you to know. It's not about special knowledge. It's not about special secrets that you have to uncover. I want you to know, and I want you to be confident in what you know. You know, this really is one of those dividing lines. This is really a distinguishing mark that separates Christianity, the true gospel, from every other man-made religion. These are the things that clearly identify what is sound and what is not. And you know the first one, the first distinguishing mark is, what do they say about Jesus? That's John's other theme here. Anyone who does not confess Jesus come in the flesh is not from God. If you don't have the Son, you don't have God. And so what do they say about Jesus? Do they believe that Jesus is the eternal, self-existing God who took on human flesh? If they don't believe that, if they don't say that, it's not sound. Don't go there. But here's the other mark. Here's the other distinguishing mark. The other distinguishing mark is, was his work on the cross was it enough? You know, that's really what distinguishes the gospel of Jesus from every other man-made religion. Was it enough? Because every other man that you may know that you have eternal life. I want you to know it, and I want you to be secure in it, and I want you to be founded in that, and I want you to understand and enjoy all the ramifications of that. And in a sense, when he says this is the confidence we have this confidence in prayer because we know. Because we know who we are. Because we know who he is. Because we know we have eternal life. And that eternal life isn't based upon our works. It's based upon what he has done for us. And if we know that, if we grab a hold of that, then we can know with certainty the privilege of prayer that he's given to us. Let's look at this. This is the bold confidence that we should have. Verse 14 says, this is the confidence we have before him. And why do we have the confidence? Because we know we have eternal life. Because we know we have eternal life, we have this confidence. Verse 14, this is the confidence which we have before him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us in whatever we ask, we know that we have the request which we have asked from him. Go back and just look at that word. This is a Greek word, parousia. Parousia. And if we just look at this, a literal translation of this Greek about himself. What does he declare about us? He's declared that he loves us. He's declared that he desires to be with us. God has declared that he takes no pleasure in the death of the ungodly. God has declared and said of us that he wants us to be restored and redeemed to him, so much so that he acted upon that. And when we embrace Jesus as Savior, what does God say about us? That we are his child. That we belong to him. And again, the promise, I will never leave you or forsake you. Do you believe that? Good, thank you. We believe that. So if that's who we are, if that's the privilege that we have before God, who delights in us, who loves us, not because of what we've done, but because of what he's done. If we belong to a God who welcomes us into his presence as his own child, if we believe that we have an inheritance with Christ, why would we not come boldly into his presence? He's welcomed us there. In fact, he's commanded us there to come and to lay our heart before him. Why would we not? I want to make another statement. I want to say it personally because I have to say it personally. The statement is this. If I don't pray with a bold expectation, then I fail to understand all that Christ has accomplished. If I'm not excited to come and lay my heart before God, if I don't come with the understanding and the expectation that God hears me and cares about the things that are burdening my heart, if I don't come with an expectation that God is going to work, then I've really failed to grasp all that Jesus has done for me. Now, I'm not saying that I'm not saved at that point. But I'm saying that in that growing and that maturing, there's still more I need to grab on. If we don't come, it's similar to the statement we made a couple weeks ago, talking about loving your brother. If we don't love one another the way God has loved us, we really haven't understood how God has loved us. There's so much here. There's so much richness here to grab a hold of. And the thing that John is pointing to is, if we know that we are saved, if we know that Jesus is the Son of God, if we know that we belong to him, why wouldn't we come? And if we fail to come with that bold expectation, then we really have failed to grab and understand all that God has for us. Because John says it this way, we know that he hears us. We know that he hears us. Look again, verse 14. This is the confidence which we have before him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. We know it. We know he hears us. And we're convinced of that. And we rest on that. Now, why do we know that he hears us? Well, not because we see it. Sometimes we don't see it. Sometimes it's a long time before we see God working with what we've asked. And sometimes we almost give up praying and we lose heart, but we know that he hears us because we know who he is. So it's not because we see it, and it's not because we feel it. You know, there are some who just think that you have to work yourself almost into this spiritual hypnotic state, and you feel that something spiritual happened, and then when you feel that something spiritual happened, you know that God heard your prayer. It's not because we see it, and it's not because we feel it, and it's not because we did the right amount of work and we said the right words in the right order with the right intensity. You know why we know that he hears us? Because we know who he is. He's a God who is ever always present. He's a God who is attentive to his children. A God who loves us. A God who will not forsake us or abandon us. So we know who he is. And so we can have this confidence in prayer. But here's the problem I have. My heart says, I can't believe I see. There's got to be a catch here. There's got to be some conditions here. Because it can't really mean that we can ask anything and he gives us what we ask. There's got to be some conditions. And you know what? There are some conditions, but I suspect not nearly as many conditions as we want to add for God. Sometimes we pray and we just give God an out. We pray not really expecting him to hear. There are some conditions, and we see one of the conditions here. John says, if we ask anything according to his will, that we pray according to his will, that's really one of the conditions in prayer. And by the way, don't use that as an excuse for God. sometimes I think we do that. We pray feebly. We pray without an expectation of God hearing and answering, and then God doesn't answer, and then we say, well, must have been His will. You know what this is? Pray according to His will, and sometimes we try to make that really mysterious and a complicated thing. Let me just make it really simple for you. If you're learning to love what God loves, you're asking for the things that God loves anyway, you can be pretty sure that you're praying according to His will. If you pray for the things that God prays for, you can be pretty sure that you're praying according to His will. If your desire is to align your heart with the heart of God, there are some indications in Scripture about some things that hinder prayer. Interesting to look at these and realize that there's a common thread even in all of these. Well, one of those hindrances to prayer, we see it in James in chapter 3. James says, you have not because you ask not. You ask and don't receive because you ask with selfish motives, spend it on your own desire. So when we pray with selfish motives, we know that that's kind of a hindrance to prayer. Another indication, it's in Psalm 66, verse 18. A couple different translations. One says, if I regard iniquity, another says, if I cherish sin. You know what cherished sin is? That's when we know it's sin, but we say, but I like this one, so I'm keeping it. That's our cherished sin. And when we have that sin in our life, and we know it's sin, but we refuse to deal with it, God says, you know, that's a hindrance. Gets in the way. Another interesting indication, this is a hindrance of prayer, and we see it in 1 Peter in chapter 3, speaking specifically to husbands, but it works both ways. Husbands, live with your wives in an understanding way. It goes on to say, so that your prayers won't be hindered. The way you treat your spouse can be a hindrance to prayer. What do all these things have in common? Well, they have this in common when we come back to this understanding that prayer, first and foremost, is a function of relationship. It's a function of our relationship with God. And when we're praying not according to His will, but we're praying to spend it on our own selfishness, and we have sin that we're cherishing and hanging on to, and if our lives are corrupted, we're not treating our spouse with graciousness and honor. It's a focus that we're just, it's an indication that we're focused on us. Relationship isn't there. So what's the condition? It's living in that relationship with your loving Heavenly Father. So, give this to you really quickly. We want to spend some time at the Lord's table. But the question is, well, how do I pray with bold confidence when I really don't even know what the will of God is? If we're honest, we come to those times when we want to pray and we're laying our heart before God, but we say, God, I just don't know what your will is. How do we pray with that same bold expectation? Can I just give you my practical approach to that? Number one, pray with an honest confession. Then honestly say, God, I don't know what your will is. I was never offended by your honest advice. There are times in our lives when we say, God, I don't know what your will is, but I can't understand why this is your will. God, this season I'm going through, I hate it. And I don't want to be here, and I can't understand how this could possibly be your will. But let me lay my questions to you. God has never offended that honest confession, even that expression of frustration from our hearts. You know why? Because prayer, first and foremost, is a function of relationship. God loves to be in relationship with His children, so we come with that honest confession first and foremost. And then, on top of that, we just pray that God would reveal His heart. God, I don't know if I'm praying according to your heart. I don't know if this request is in line with you, but here's what my heart desires. Now, if that's wrong, change my heart. Align my heart with your heart. Reveal your heart for me, God, in this thing. And in the meantime, I'm just going to give you what my heart desires. But above all, change my heart. And then, pray with expectation. God, I just expect to see you work. I don't know how you're going to work. I don't understand it. I don't understand the circumstance that I'm in. I know that you're going to work. I don't know how. I'm just going to pay attention to you. I'm going to keep praying, and I'm going to keep paying attention to you. That's how we do it. But how do we reconcile promise to our experience? Promise says this. This is the confidence that we have before Him, that if we ask anything according to His will, He hears us. And if we know that He hears us in whatever we ask, we know that we have the request which we have asked from Him. That's the promise. How do we reconcile that? Because I don't know about you, but I've prayed for things and I haven't seen them. Anybody else? How do we reconcile that? Well, here's the thing. Let's go back and just grab a hold of this more than anything. God and His Word, and you know, it's a poor approach to Scripture to simply say, well, it must not really mean that. It says you have whatever you ask, but it must not really mean that. Don't go there. That's really a poor approach to understanding Scripture, to understand if it doesn't make obvious sense to us, then we say, well, it must not mean what it says. It doesn't mean what it says. The fault isn't in what it says. The fault is in what we understand. God and His Word. You know, the word here is that we have the request. That word have means that we hold it. When we make that request before God, here's the picture that John is painting for us. We already hold it in our hands. And this is not kind of that new age mystical thinking that the answer is within you. It's not saying the answer is already within you. You already know what the answer is. This is when we request before God, we feel confident that God is already there. Ready. So how do we understand that? Well, we come back to this phrase, and this is kind of part of the book of Habakkuk. But when we would cry out to God and say, God, I don't understand what you're doing. And I've prayed, and I don't see any answer to that, and you promised that you would answer, and I don't see it, I don't understand it, just in that quiet, clear voice, that compassionate voice, I think we can hear God whisper in our ear this truth. And just because you didn't see it, doesn't mean I wasn't working. That was his answer to Habakkuk, by the way. Just because you didn't see it, doesn't mean that I wasn't working. Been working all along, and maybe that's the confidence that we have. This is how we reconcile. We know that He hears us because of who He is, not because of who we are. And we know that when we have that request before Him, we know that God is already at work with the things that concern us. In that sense, we already hold it in our hands. God is already working. It might be some time before He reveals that to us, but we know that He's already at work. And when we do that, we can pray with a bold confidence. He's a God who never changes. Not based on who we are, but based on what He has done. We want to spend some time right here at the Lord's table. Let's have our hands on the floor, our servers, our elders, and those who are helping with that. This is a reminder of what we have in Christ. This is a reminder that the eternal, self-existing God took on human flesh for us and went to the cross for us to redeem us. And it wasn't because of what we had done. It's because of who He is. This is a reminder of shed blood that was sufficient to pay the debt. This doesn't save us. Partaking of this little piece of bread and this cup of juice doesn't cover our sins. This doesn't make us righteous for another season. But it's a reminder of what did. Of His heart. Of His love. Of His action. Of His sacrifice. So if you know Jesus as your Savior, this is your reminder. Join with us. There are some churches and fellowships.